2 Kings, chapter 2. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied. "So be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha. The Lord has sent me to Jericho." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," he replied. "So be quiet." Then Elisha said to him, "Stay here. The Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on. 50 men from the company of the prophet went and stood at a distance, facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elisha took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and two of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you?" "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You have asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his garment and tore it in two. Elisha then picked up Elijah's cloak, and had fallen from him, and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and struck the water with it. "Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" he asked. When he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. The company of the prophets from Jericho, who were watching, said, "The spirit of Elijah is resting on Elisha." And they went to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. "Look," they said, "we your servants have 50 able men. Let them go and look for your master. Perhaps the spirit of the Lord has picked him up and set him down in some mountain or in some valley." "No," Elijah replied, "do not send them." But they persisted until he was too embarrassed to refuse. So he said, "Send them." And they sent 50 men who searched for 3 days, but did not find him. When they returned to Elisha, who was staying in Jericho, he said to them, "Didn't I tell you not to go?" The people of the city said to Elisha, "Look, our Lord, this town is well situated, as you can see, but the water is bad and the land is unproductive. Bring me a new bowl," he said, "and put salt in it." So they brought it to him. Then he went out to the spring and threw the salt into it, saying, "This is what the Lord says, I have healed this water. Never again will it cause death or make the land unproductive." And the water has remained pure to this day, according to the word Elisha had spoken. From there, Elisha went up to Bethel. As he was walking along the road, some boys came out of the town and jeered at him. "Get out of here, Baldy," they said. "Get out of here, Baldy." He turned around, looked at them, and called down a curse on them in the name of the Lord. Then two bears came out of the woods and mauled 42 of the boys. And he went on to Mount Carmel, and from there returned to Samaria.
Thank you, Don. Please do keep your Bibles open there. I'm going to pray once again before we turn to reflect together on that passage. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the assurance we have that your word is a lamp to our feet, a light to our path. We pray that it will be exactly that now to us as we work together through this a very strange narrative, this very distant narrative, see what you're having to say to us. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, look, it's just 6 days away now. It doesn't matter who you are. You could be a royalist or a Republican, British-born or from overseas. It doesn't matter. The reality is we are just 6 days away from one of the most significant events in the ceremonial life of our nation, certainly of my lifetime, I guess of most of our lifetimes. This is the big one, the coronation of King Charles III. Now, there's plenty for the media to talk about, the commentators outside the coronation service. They've got quiches, they've got processions, they've got air-conditioned royal carriages to talk about. They've even got, you know, why Meghan Markle isn't in town. Lots of things to talk about. But, of course, the real action is to take place inside Westminster Abbey, where every single act, every object is just laden with symbolism. The venue itself, of course, where kings and queens have been crowned for the best part of 1,000 years, the chair, the stone, the ring, the oil of anointing, the scepter, the orb, the crown, the trumpet fanfare, the shouts, God save the king, the oaths, presentation of a Bible, and so on. Each of these things is a powerful symbol of this or that authority, commitment, recognition, whatever it is. But taken together, they are actually symbolic of something else, aren't they? Continuity. Continuity. That is the name of the game, isn't it? With all this royal ritual, it's almost the obsession, you might say. The queen is dead, long live the king. That's the proclamation that's made when the monarch dies. At the point, total continuity. The successor is already in place. At the moment the queen died in September, ever since then, there's been this well-rehearsed sequence of events, culminating, of course, in this coming Saturday, all to demonstrate that one thing the monarchy does so well, provides in bucket loads, stability, uninterrupted service, enduring provision of royal reign. Now, why is that important? Why is it that even after Prince Harry's book came out and a relatively unpopular monarch takes over and republicanism is on the rise, why is it that still twice as many people want the monarchy to continue as not? Why does our nation want this institution to carry on in this seamless kind of way? Well, presumably it's just a comfort, isn't it? Isn't that part of it? When society is fracturing and world events are just totally out of control, and prime ministers seem to come and go about every 2 weeks, there's still a monarch on the throne. That stability is in some way, on some level, just deeply reassuring for many in our nation. When everything is going pear-shaped, continuity breeds confidence. 2,500 years ago, everything had gone wrong. Everything had gone pear-shaped for the people of God. They desperately needed reassuring. They were in the market for a big boost of confidence. Israel had been split into two kingdoms, and after centuries of decline, the unthinkable had happened. Both kingdoms, north and south, had fallen. And the people were just dazed. They were in a state of kind of national shock. And hard questions could not be avoided. Hardest of all, of course, were questions about their God. Is he still there? Does he still care? Will his voice be heard again? Actually, those questions are not uncommon even today. I imagine if we took this microphone around the room, we'd find they weren't that uncommon among us in this room. Maybe for you, it's a case of spiritual nostalgia. God felt so real when you were younger. His presence in your life was just so obvious, but now it feels so far away. Maybe it's a case of life circumstances. One thing after another in your life has wrenched things apart. In earlier times, you used to pray and you'd experience answered prayer after answered prayer. But now life just seems to have been turned upside down and you're left wondering, well, does he still care? Or maybe it's how you feel when you open up your Bible. Once that experience was like words coming straight from God's heart to your heart. Words of comfort, words of challenge, words of reminder, whatever they were words of life. And now you pick up your Bible and it's anything but that. Words on a page. Is he still there? Does he still care? Will his voice be heard again? They're questions most of us will have asked at some point, and I certainly have. And if you haven't asked those kind of questions, I can pretty much guarantee that one day you will. And as I say, there were questions buzzing around for the exiles in Babylon, the people for whom this book of 2 Kings, was written. But in fact, at heart, it's the question Elisha articulates himself in the middle of this passage, after that seismic event in the life of the nation, the departure of the mouthpiece of God, the prophet Elijah. The middle of verse 14. Where now is the God of Elijah? With the great man of God gone, what of God himself? Is he still there? Does he still care? Will his voice be heard again? Those are exactly the kind of questions answered in this account of the succession of Elijah by his apprentice Elisha. Sorry about the similarity of the two names. We're going to have to get used to that a bit today. It's recounted at length, and it's full of the kind of symbols that we were talking about earlier on, symbols that point individually to particular things, but taken together will point us to a clear answer to those questions. So let's look at those symbolic moments in the succession story. First of all comes the journey. No coronation would be complete without a procession, but this one is slightly unusual, partly because it's just the two men, the outgoing prophet and the incoming one. So verse 1, when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Now, it's just the two of them on this journey. There's the master and the master's apprentice. Turns out Elijah has a bit of a multi-campus ministry going on around the place, schools of prophets in various places. And certainly it looks like this journey is, well, at least to begin with, just a kind of farewell tour to those various campuses. There's the company of prophets, verse 3, at Bethel. There's another one again in verse 5 at Jericho. And it seems like there's a whole bunch around at the Jordan as well, verse 7. All of them seem to get what's going on. They get that this really is the end of an era. So, for example, in verse 3 again, do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today? They say to Elisha. Same in verse 5 at Jericho. Both times, it seems like a bit of a taboo subject. Yes, I know, whispers Elisha. So be quiet. Shh. But the really odd thing about this journey is the way Elijah keeps apparently trying to shake off young Elisha, keeps trying to give him the slip, even behind. So verse 2, for example, Elijah said to Elisha, stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel. Same in verse 4. Same in verse 6. Stay here. The Lord has sent me. Now, why is he trying to do this? What's he trying to accomplish? Why does he want to get rid of Elisha so much? Well, given the flow of the passage, it seems to be a kind of test. It's asking the question, just how committed is Elisha to following Elijah to the end and beyond? What is this young man really made of? How easily will he be put off? Well, if that is it, if it is a test, then clearly Elisha seems to pass with flying colors. So in verse 2, Elisha said, as surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you. Yeah, three times it comes. It has a kind of Ruth and Naomi feel to it, doesn't it? This kind of clinging here, if you're familiar with that story. Elisha will not be put off. He won't stay behind. There's total commitment, ready to go all the way. But there's still a question kind of hanging over here. What exactly is he committed to? What does he think lies ahead for him? The answer needs a little bit of work, but it's to be found in the place names of the journey. I told you this chapter was all about symbols. Well, in this case, it's about geographic symbols. Let me put a map up there so you can kind of see it a little bit more easily than just having the words on the page. You see, when Elisha follows Elijah from Bethel to Jericho to Jordan, what's he doing? Well, he's retracing, kind of in reverse, the first steps of Joshua into the Promised Land. The time when Joshua led Israel across the Jordan, near the other Gilgal, which is just confusing, to Jericho, to Bethel, and beyond. Now, I don't know when the penny really dropped for Elisha about where they're going and why, but I'm sure it dropped eventually. He's following Elijah all the way back to where it started, as if to say, I know what my role is to do it all again. It's to be a new Joshua that the people of God need in this generation. Joshua himself, of course, was the original great successor. He succeeded Moses, and he led Israel from the Jordan to Jericho, to Bethel, and beyond into the land to conquer what needed to be conquered so that Israel could live in a land that had been knee-deep in idolatry, but still stay faithful to the Lord their God. Elisha will succeed Elijah and lead Israel again in overthrowing idolatry and bringing people back to being faithful to the Lord their God. That was going to be his mission, should he choose to accept it. And it looks like he will. He's committed to it. And so their journey together ends where Joshua's began. Verses 7 and 8, the Jordan River. And just as the river had parted for Joshua when he came in and the Israelites were able to cross over dry land, so it does for Elijah and his apprentice, who's clearly passed the test. So verse 8, you've got 50 witnesses watching, and what happens? Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right, to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. So there is the journey. It seems to be answering the question of this new man. Is he really committed to this role of succeeding Elijah? Now, in a small way, we're asking that question all the time here at Christ Church. We take very seriously the responsibility we have as a church to raise up the next generation of ministers of the word. In fact, 2 Timothy 2 verse 2 could almost be our strapline in this kind of area. The things you've heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. But that word reliable is the key one there. We're looking for people who really are reliable, who we can trust to step up into ministry roles, take up the baton and so continue to bring the word to those who need to hear it. But there's more. Next symbol, it's the vision. And all those symbols we're going to see on Saturday in the coronation are important for the watching nation. But they're perhaps even more important for the monarch himself. The monarch has to grasp what this role is that he is taking on and what it isn't. And actually it's no different for the prophet here. In verse 9, Elisha gets an offer from Elijah that he cannot refuse. Tell me, what can I do for you before I am taken from you? Now that is something, isn't it? What a thing to be asked. What's he going to say to that kind of offer? I'm good, thanks. I've got everything I need. Not really. In fact, far from that, his answer is really quite bold. Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit, Elisha replied. Well, I said bold. That is bordering on presumptuous, you might say, wouldn't you? But not if you understand what he's really saying, what the phrase itself, double portion, that's just a roundabout way of talking about the inheritance of the firstborn son. Suppose a man dies, and he's got four fields, and he's got three sons. Now, that might be a bit of a conundrum. You know, what do you do? You've got two chocolate bars left with three, whatever. You know, so how do you divvy these things up? But actually, that's not the issue at all. Deuteronomy 21, verse 17, the firstborn son gets a double inheritance. He gets two fields, and the others get one each. That's how it works. Let me inherit a double portion. Is not Elisha saying he just wants to be twice as spirit-saturated as Elijah? He's saying, I want to be considered your firstborn son, your heir. That's what he's asking. He's up for being the successor. That's why he cries out in verse 12, my father, that's the relationship he wants. His desire is to be the heir. I mean, just think about all those people they've seen on the journey so far today. Hundreds of apprentice prophets across those various campuses. They could all be contenders, couldn't they? But no, in obedience to God, Elisha wants to be the primary successor. And Elisha's answer, Elijah's answer, well, looks a bit ambiguous, doesn't it? It's a kind of maybe. So verse 10, if you see me when I'm taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not. Seems a little bit random, doesn't it? But again, as you could probably guess, there's more symbolism at work here. In the Bible, seeing a sight is often language that's been used for grasping a reality. It's the same in English, actually, isn't it? When you say, I see, you're often saying, oh, well, I understand. So what is it that Elisha may or may not see in this kind of play on words here? Verse 11. As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them. And Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel. Now that's the vision. Well, that's what he sees. But what is it that he actually sees? The key thing here is that Elijah is not in the chariot. Despite any artwork you may have seen over the years from the medieval times or anything like that, Elijah is not in the chariot. Elijah is the chariot and the horses. The chariots and the horses, that was the army. That's what Israel looked to for their protection. But as Elisha sees this vision with his eyes, what he grasps is that the role of Elijah, and presumably any successor, is to be the protector of Israel. It's only God's word that can keep them falling off the cliff edges. It's only God's word that can keep them safe. So they need the one who will speak God's word to them. And now we're assured that Elisha understands that. He gets the role. Actually, it's not dissimilar in ministry today. If you see your child running into a busy road, what do? You scream out at them, don't you? They turn around, they see what's going on, and they get out the way. And nobody likes being screamed at, but that's the way you're kept safe if you're a little kid who's run into the road. And actually, that's part of what ministry involves. Not physically screaming, obviously, but certainly warning. Telling the truth about where this kind of behavior, this kind of attitude actually leads. Giving people an opportunity to turn in repentance. Jesus told the truth, even if it was uncomfortable, and so must we, mustn't we? It's got to be what we're about. Because that's how people ultimately will be kept safe on the day of judgment. But the symbols continue. Next one is a piece of clothing. Now, there will be very splendid robes, I'm sure, on display this coming Saturday that our monarch will be wearing, and probably everybody else will be wearing rather splendid clothes as well. Here in our story, though, the item of clothing in question is just a hairy, smelly cloak. But it's no less symbolic. At the end of verse 12, Elisha has torn his own coat. But now we read verse 13. Elisha picked up Elijah's cloak that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the banks of the Jordan. This, of course, is where we get our English expression, taking up the mantle, that kind of thing. I'm sure you've heard that expression. Here's where it comes from. But actually, that little moment looks back to the first time Elijah and Elisha even met. The reason both Elijah and Elisha are going through this whole rigmarole is that God himself has decreed that this succession should take place. Back in 1 Kings 19 and verse 16, the Lord says to Elijah, anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat from Abel-Meholah, to succeed you as prophet. Actually, right back then, still in 1 Kings 19, it started that succession. He'd put his cloak on Elisha for the first time. But now, sometime later, with Elijah gone, it's Elisha who has to take the initiative. He picks up the cloak. And by doing so, he accepts the responsibility. And he doesn't actually put it on. Just as Elisha had struck the water with his cloak and the river had parted, so Elisha too strikes it with the same cloak. End of verse 14, when he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. Two men, same result. Clearly we have a successor. Now the others are a bit slower to grasp what's really going on here. The company of prophets do recognize him as successor, at least in theory. So verse 15, the spirit of Elijah is resting on Elisha, they say. And they went out to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. So in theory they're there. But their minds are still clearly stuck in the past. They embark on this wild goose chase for Elijah, trying to find him. Alive or dead, it's not clear what they're expecting. So they're confused. But at least Elijah himself has answered the question. He accepts the burden of this role. And it is a heavy one, isn't it? The work of a prophet was to look back to the past, call people back to their commitments to follow the Lord, and to look forward to the future. That is, warn them of the consequences if they don't. It was to challenge authority. Speak truth to power, as we say. And that can be uncomfortable. But the word of God does need to be spoken. And Elijah is happy to shoulder the responsibility of speaking it. I wonder where God has put you. I wonder what circumstances he's placed you in. What responsibilities to speak are presented to you. And what have you accept them? Let's look quickly at the final symbols of this succession story. And they are the signs that Elisha now performs. Miracles in the Bible, you may have noticed, are actually very unevenly distributed. There's a cluster of them for a few years around the time of Moses, when God is setting up his relationship with his people. There's this cluster around the time of Elijah and Elisha, when God is seeking to restore his relationship with his people. There's a small cluster in the time of Daniel, when he's trying to maintain his relationship with his people in exile. There's another cluster for a few years around the time of Jesus and his apostles, when God is redefining his relationship with his people. Other than that, talk of miracles is actually fairly light. Nothing at all when things are just motoring along. King David, King Solomon, even the later ministry of the Apostle Paul, nothing really. Now, why is that? Well, apparently because miracles are not just kind of crass displays of power. Look what I can do. No, they're generally given to call attention to very significant things, moments, people. We've got two of them here. The first is a sign of blessing. As Elisha retraces his steps from the Jordan and comes to Jericho, he finds a town in trouble. Verse 19, the water is bad and the land is unproductive, they say. Literally, it is miscarriage causing. And miscarriage is an awful thing. Dozens of people at church have been through that experience. It's horrible, it's very hard. Nevertheless, these people accept the need, accept the hardship, but respond to it by inviting Elisha to help, putting themselves at the mercy of the Lord's prophet. And so what does Elisha do? He cleanses the water with nothing more than a scoop of salt and pronounces the blessing of God. And amazingly, it holds. New life has come to this town of Jericho through the prophet. The second sign, though, is a sign of curse. Now, we find this story, I take it, probably a bit objectionable. What happens here? Elisha reaches Bethel. A bunch of kids come out and taunt him for being bollockly challenged, shall we say. End of verse 23. Get out of here, baldy, they say. And what happens as a result? 42 of them get mauled by a couple of bears, apparently just for having big mouths. Seems a bit over the top, doesn't it? Now, we don't know how many people actually died, if anybody actually died. We don't know any details really here. But it seems likely that this is just the reverse of Jericho. In Jericho, they invited him in and sought his help. Here, they send a posse of youths to keep the Lord's prophet out. They don't want him anywhere near their town. And they find themselves cursed. Two different things, two different signs, but in different ways pointing to the same reality. They are confirmations of Elisha's status as one who speaks for God. He pronounces both God's blessings and God's curses, and both come to pass. Will he carry out his role? Yes, he will. And so once again, here is all we need to see that succession, true succession, has taken place. Moses had his Joshua, and now Elijah has his Elisha. But years later, of course, a new Elijah would come with his hair shirt and his leather belt, you remember? Out of the desert, people would flock to John the Baptist. His ministry would be hugely impactful. And yet he too would have his successor, wouldn't he? I baptize you with water, he said, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Moses would have his Joshua, Elijah would have his Elisha, and John would have his Jesus. And in each case, you notice, not only does succession happen, but the successor is greater in his accomplishments. See, yes, Moses prepared the people to enter the land, but Joshua actually took them in. Yes, Elijah warned the people for years, but Elisha did far more miracles, served Israel for far longer, enacted the blessings and the curses more visibly. And yes, John brought a message of repentance. He brought baptism with water, but Jesus accomplished salvation and sent the Holy Spirit to apply. So where does that leave us with those questions we pondered about God? These different symbols, what are they actually saying when you put them all together? Well, you remember the questions. Is he still there? Does he still care? Will his voice be heard again? In Elisha, we find God's yes to each of those troubled questions. Divine provision did not stop with Elijah. God didn't just do half a job and then head for the door. No, he stayed with his people. He stays for his people. He stays speaking to his people. And in the new Elisha, in Jesus himself, we see that spelt out even more clearly, don't we? Is he still there? I am with you till the end of the age, says Jesus. He's still there. The only question is whether we'll accept him in our life. Does he still care? Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest, says Jesus. He still cares. Our question is, will we trust him? Will his voice be heard again? But again, hear Jesus. When he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. The words of Jesus, brought to us by the Spirit of Jesus, is, of course, the voice of God still being heard today. Any questions? Will we listen to it? I'm going to stop there and just give us a moment to perhaps process some of those things. See what the Lord is saying to us today. Heavenly Father, you've said it to us in Elisha, and you've said it to us even more clearly in the new Elisha. You do still care. You are still there. Your voice continues to be heard. And so we do ask for the Spirit's help in recognizing the answer to those questions, recognizing the truth of those assurances. Might we be those who do find a home for you to dwell in our lives. Those who do trust you to be kind as a heavenly Father is to his children, to care for you, to listen to you as you continue to speak through your word. We ask that each day you'll be working us, giving us confidence that you continue to reign, giving us assurance, giving us stability in our lives as we live them against the backdrop of one who really does walk with us, continues to address us. The glory of Jesus.